I'm also being part of this project, BEAGLE, and all of this wonderful collaboration that is forward during this process. In my presentation, I will try to focus on Neoplatonic virtue ethics. My aim actually is twofold. First of all, to present what seems to be unique for the Neoplatonists, particularly the times Porphyry and the Iamblichus, considering virtue and virtue ethics in connection to Plato and Aristotle. And secondly, this is the second part of the presentation, is to suggest some connections between the Neoplatonic perspective of virtue ethics with some modern discussions of virtue ethics, and just to suggest finally of some bioethical education. So this could be part of a discussion that we would have afterwards. But first of all, I would like just to note that Neoplatonic ethics is a development, a philosophical development, of the Platonic and the Aristotelian perspective of ethics. And sometimes there is a synthesis, there is a combination between the two. First of all, in Plotinus, we see really an interesting combination with some emphasis on the self, and particularly in three different Enneads, in a short treatise on virtue, 1-2, on dialectic and on well-being, particularly well-being where the wise man, the spudaios, is described in this case. His student Porphyry, in his sentences, an aphorometros noita, actually, he tries to systematize, to classify the four cardinal virtues that Plotinus works, taken from the Platonic and the Aristotelian tradition. And then we can have seen the Iamblichus in a lost work on virtues, an expansion of the virtues. He includes other virtues, other classification of virtues, with revisiting somehow the Aristotelian perspective of habituation, where for Plotinus seems to be something that goes in a more theoretical perspective. Just to very briefly to see that for Plato, in his own polis, the virtues are really a prerequisite for character development and human excellence. And well-being actually should be in accordance with the perfection of the forms. So for Plato, the political statement, along with the metaphysical statement, seems to be really close. So the life of the citizen follows virtue, becomes excellent in accordance always with the theory of the forms. In a more practical sense, Aristotle focuses on human behavior. I don't mean that Plato actually is not considering human behavior, but he wants actually to suggest something, some practical philosophical perspectives. So for Aristotle, the character and the behavior is closely related to the community. And we know that he tries to suggest the idea of mesotis, which is this intermediate state between different extremes, and the end is well-being and eudaimonia, this happiness that should be achieved by the wise. So reason here in the human mind is extremely important, not necessarily in the world of the forms, but also in practical reasoning of everyday life. So this practical perspective of ethics is important. What is also important, and I would like to highlight in the next slide, is that for Aristotle, there is an interesting distinction, firstly between means and ends, where the final end is eudaimonia, and the distinction between ethical virtues and intellectual virtues, where for Plotinus is really interesting. So, in Plotinus, actually, maybe the most important Neoplatonist, if we can use this term, for him he was just a Platonist, he doesn't seem to accept the idea of a Neoplatonic idea, this is our own modern classification of it. For him, virtue is a quality, an intrinsic quality of human character. And the excellence of the moral soul is a catharsis, is a purity. Also in Plato we can see this purity. And of course, contemplating the forms. Actually the forms in Plotinus are not the forms as we see them in Plato. There is a synthesis between Plato's theory of the forms and the nous in Aristotle. So there is this self-thinking mind. We can say that the forms thinking themselves in Plotinus. So we see that he emphasizes the importance of an intrinsic value in the soul that can be purified. This is taken from Plato, if we can make this generalization. In case of Aristotle, he is accepting the idea that virtues do not exist in the world of the forms. This is something very interesting. It's like accepting the idea that there is an instrumental value somehow to virtues. When we are identified with a higher world of the forms, virtues are lost. There are no virtues at the intelligible world. So, intelligible beings like gods, they do not possess virtues. We need the virtues in order to be developed. And finally, the distinction between intellectual virtues and ethical virtues are really accepted from Plotinus, and he emphasizes intellectual virtues. So, his theory seems to be self-directed, and this is an important aspect which I would like to underline today. So the self is in the center. I don't mean that a kind of a selfish or egoistic ethics. For him, the development of the self, and particularly in the Neoplatonic tradition, is extremely important. And he believes that there is a dual selfhood, a dual aspect self. For him, there is the perceptible self, the self of the perceptible world, and the higher self, always in the intelligible world of the forms. For him, the aim is to become like your higher self, not the lower self, without meaning that there is a duality in a Cartesian perspective. It's not a Cartesian duality, it is just a dual aspect theory. So the soul has two different aspects, at the same time living in the world of the senses and at the same time living in the world of the forms. This is something unique. He emphasizes the idea of self-determination. This is extremely important for him because human freedom is based on the idea that you can be determined only with internal determinations. For him, he's a little bit pessimistic. There is no praxis, there is no actions that is fully determined by yourself. So if something depends on your own powers, it is only changing yourself. So these internal contemplations and self-determinations is a very interesting aspect of a very interesting self-determination of ethical framework, which just is interesting also today about this self-determination aspect. And for him, this inner activity of the soul purifies the soul, and at the same time, it is not a matter of habit, as in Aristotle, the issue of virtue. It is like an internal excellence. How these habits become states of the soul. So the wise man for Plotinus first becomes perfect and then acts. The aim is this one, to become godlike. This is the reply, the Platonic or the Pythagorean reply to what Aristotle suggests, yes, I want to have eudaimonia. This is my end. This is the end of every human being, to become happy. To have a well-being both in the polis and himself, herself, in every single being. For Plotinus, the answer of the Platonic tradition is in Plato's Theaetetus. The A is to become godlike kata to dunaton, as far as possible. Plotinus removes the last part. You can become God. You can become godlike. Because according to his virtue ethics, this purification leads you to the higher world of the forms. So he emphasizes this self-directed metaphysics. So the virtue of wisdom is the highest one, and I'm going to refer to the four cardinal virtues. So the wise man, the spudaios, a term, or the sophos, he's using both terms in different ways, follows this life of intellect like being the everyday life of his own world. he is not affected by sufferings or misfortunes of the body. This reminds us a little bit the Stoic idea of apatheia, remaining a kind of apathy, staying away from different affections. But on the other hand, he is not unfriendly. He is not inconsiderate. He is not actually not caring for the others. He is caring for the others. He is in a kind of appreciation of the other soul, but not in terms of affections, but in terms of the appreciation of some sister souls that they are having the same aim. Because sometimes we are confusing the unfriendly attitude with that Plotinus refers to this as a contemplation. And for him, for Plato, virtue has no master. So if virtue is the answer, so virtue really leads us to be purely dependent on our own. And as we see in this last part of the slide, he is changing the idea of hexis. Because for Aristotle, virtue is a habituation. You are becoming wise by exercising every day the perfection according to the forms and according to the different virtues that we have. For him, hexis is not an external activity for Plotinus. It is just an activity of theoreia. It's not an activity of praxis. It is an activity that comes internally in yourself before becoming wise and then acting. So, just very briefly, we can see in this table how in Ennead I.2 On Virtues, and I'm afraid that Plotinus would not like this table. Okay, for the moment, let's use it. Because he analyzes, it's a very short, very interesting, in Ennead I.2, in the first and the second treatise, very short treatise, and he is working on the different virtues: courage, self-control, justice, wisdom. These are the four Platonic cardinal virtues. And he's trying in his own system, if it is a system, or with his own different perspectives, to see how they work. So for instance, in the case of a civic state, we have courage in ruling emotions, self-control to become harmony between passion and reason, tries to give some definitions. Wisdom is discursive reason, or in the case of nous, courage is becoming abiding pure in itself, so living. So you can see some different, I don't think we have the time probably today to go in detail, but he is trying to classify the virtues with different states of being, following particularly the hypostasis of the soul and the mind, and how we are ruling in this case. So we have some kind of a first classification in terms of an ontological distinction between the different states. Then Porphyry, in his sentences, takes this analysis and systematizes the virtues, and he is offering particular four different levels in a scale of virtues. So we have clearly political virtues or seven virtues. We have clear purificatory virtues that purify the soul. We have the theoretical virtues and we have the paradigmatic virtues. This is the difference with Plotinus. Plotinus never refers to paradigmatic virtues. Why? Because as I mentioned before, the virtues are not in the world of the forms. The virtues only exist at the level of the soul, not in the level of the forms and the level of the mind. The higher mind, the mind of the divine mind, in some case. So he gives a definition. So first of all, the political and self-civic virtues aim to moderate passion and to perform contrary to the laws of human nature, controlling, again, human emotions. Purificator virtues detach the soul completely from passions. Contemplative virtues apply to the soul's pure intellectual activities, without any concern about passions. And paradigmatic virtues are just the exemplars and the archetypes of virtues. So we see that this classification works. And if we compare the times with Porphyry, we can see that they are very close. So political goes to this civic virtue. That means that Plotinus is not necessarily a completely contemplative part of virtues. There are balance of civic virtues that we need to exercise dialectic. But for him, the priority seems to be on the self. The priority is the self. Priority is not the praxis, it's not the practical thing, which sounds strange in our minds today, because we have learned to think ethics in an action-based perspective. For Plotinus, it's mainly a self-directed perspective. So he gives this metaphysical and psychological element in ethics, which is, for me, very useful for education. Not the metaphysical aspect, but the psychological. It's a psycho-centric, if we can use this expression. Purification goes to an ascending process. It's like a progress, starting from the lower, if the lower is the civic nature, and going up with the virtues and the purifications, to the theoretical, which is the soul connected to nous, and just becoming nous. Porphyry would accept Plotinus' idea that if you want to become happy, you have to become happiness. So you have to become the demonic. You have to act like the demonic. It's not an imitation. It's an identification between you and your demonic. So you're not just happy, you are happiness. So this great emphasis of becoming like something, becoming like God, becoming like the demonia, is the key, which sounds, I know, really strange and too theoretical and very experiential. With the Iamblichus, you have a more complicated situation, and I'm going to almost finish with the Neoplatonists here. He adds three more levels of virtues. Not only the civic purification, contemplative, paradigmatic, he gives a level, probably for political also purpose, or theological purposes, a level, because this is, let's say, from the lower to the higher, it's an ascending division, maybe it could be reversed. The hieratic virtues seems to be the higher form, above even the forms. But it's not this part which is, for me, extremely interesting. It is that below the civic virtue, we have two levels, the ethical and the natural virtues. He names ethical virtues, virtues that seem to be connected directly to what Aristotle would accept as practical philosophy. We have a really interesting reconsideration of the Aristotelian theory through the Neoplatonists. And of course the natural virtue. And that is why he is emphasized the term ethismos. He is bringing back the political education, educational and social needs to identify what means to be virtuous. And the second aspect, which is actually important for further research, is that he emphasized that arete, virtue, is important for the cultivation both of children and certain animals. And this is, for me, is a question mark for further research. Probably is the first time, as far as I know, that we have this reference to a kind of education of certain animals. This word on virtue seems to be lost. We have only some fragments. There are some letters to students of the Iamblichus that he emphasizes the education of children, he emphasizes the importance of the practical thing of what it means to work with virtues during the process of education. And the educational importance is clearly based, whereas we don't see this element in Plotinus and not so much in Porphyry. So the Iamblichus seems to return to the necessity to re-establish virtue in an Aristotelian basis of praxis. Somehow. This is part of further research we can see in the future, somehow. So a virtue ethics education for him is presupposed, and this is an important one, presupposed for political virtues. You cannot have the maturity and the rationality of the political virtues without having the ethical virtues. Not even to say the natural virtues. So we say that the ethical is a prerequisite of the political. And the educational is a prerequisite of the civic. Keeping in mind this idea, I would like to bring this modern perspective from Alasdair MacIntyre, who suggested in his work on virtues that we have to revisit ancient virtue ethics. And he believes that actually there is a fragmentation between the moral agent who acts and the moral action. There's a long criticism, a very interesting book. Actually, this book seems to change how we consider the virtue ethics today. And for him, actually, the excellence of the individual in personal and public life, and he actually brings the issue of the community, is important to be reinforced with ancient virtue ethics. He referring to Aristotle, but also to Dostoevsky, to Kierkegaard, and Friedrich Nietzsche. He supports that we need to have this perspective that the virtue ethics considers. Keeping in mind this treatise to enlightenment mainly, and this division, I would say that it really, this is some part of the suggestion that I would like to bring today, that this Platonic, late Platonic perspective, which has this self-directed approach, first of all, is a character-based perspective that we need in education. The deontological, the Kantian, the utilitarian perspectives are really useful, but they are action-based. Sometimes a micro-based perspective is more important than a macro-based, a character-based than an action-based. So this emphasizes the importance of a self-directed moral agency, where in virtue ethics we can find the alternatives, not only in Aristotle, but also in other theories. And then there is a self-directed motivational approach. Students could be motivated as future civic citizens to be engaged, to participate in the formulation of policies, in standards, whatever we wish. This is a motivational approach that could be based. And virtue ethics could be part of what we consider as a bioethical education in terms of applied ethics, if now we are discussing between three different aspects. The Kantian one, the utilitarian one, and the virtue ethics one, which is in applied ethics really considered, and bioethics is part of the applied ethics and the normative ethics framework. So students are developing this kind of moral agency. Students are educated in becoming self-just with values and rights, responsibilities, respect, which is also respect, it's not only between humans, but there is also this biodiversity idea, if we consider Iamblichus' consideration that we have to see animals as important beings, that they are part of our own community, but this is part of a further research and how far this could be considered. So, closing this, all these suggestions, having in mind these three different pillars in Beagle, I would say that virtue ethics is this self-directed perspective that will have a reconsideration of the ethical values in terms of the self and by extension on nature somehow. We have the social values in citizenship emphasized probably post-Plotinianly or this consideration of Iamblichus, Porphyry, or Macrobius, or Olympiodorus later on, how they could be integrated within the city and understand the difficulties between comparing a different political system and social system in the ancient times with today, but this is part of a wider discussion. And some environmental values, because I think that there is a really a very serious consideration in Neoplatonist how nature can be seen as a pure organism, and how this organism could be integrated in harmony with different species and beings. So there is a very interesting biological and ethical discussion, not so part of current research, but could be part of this current research. So I think that virtue ethics could be a way to perceive what are the three different pillars of a bioethical education, and particularly in Beagle. Thank you very much.